Swedenborg's 332nd birthday celebration. It's a lecture by Devin Zuber and lunch and fellowship, and we're going to be carpooling, leaving the church at 10, and Kelly will be driving. So if you haven't signed up and want to come, please do that. There's also a suggestion box for hymns on the parlor table. We'd love to have your ideas. Dean, did you have a question?
No, I just wanted to say it was a very nice lunch we had here a couple of years ago.
Yes.
And Devin Zuber. Very interesting speaker. He's very, very knowledgeable.
Thank you. And I also want to mention our food pantry collections, our CDs and books on the bookshelf by the coffee station, and also the side desk in the office. Those are all free. We hope you'll take them to read and share with friends. And we do need coffee hour signups for March and April. So that's all in the other room. Business having been taken care of. Big sigh. Let's join together in worship. And our first hymn is an insert in your bulletin, and it is a song called Let Every Moment Be a Time for Prayer by Lori Turley. I invite you to rise.
Thank you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please join in the responsive call to worship. Do not fret because of evildoers. Be not envious towards wrongdoers.
For they will live like the grass and fade like green herbs.
Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and cultivate faithfulness.
Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart.
Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he will do it.
He will bring forth your righteousness as light, and your judgment as the noonday.
Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him.
Do not fret because of those who prosper in evil ways, because of those who carry out wicked schemes.
Cease from anger, and forsake wrath. Do not fret, it leads only to evildoing. But those who wait for the Lord, they will inherit the land. Amen. Please be seated. Now you each have a little slip of paper in your bulletin today. It's a little prayer that my grandmother taught. And I wanted to share that with us today because it's very simple, but it covers almost everything I can think of why we would need prayer. It's all in there. Lord, thou knowest how I live. The Lord knows us. The Lord has all the information he needs to know us. We're the ones who need to pray. Lord, thou knowest how I live. It's humility before the Lord. All I've done amiss, forgive. We're asking for forgiveness because we know we make mistakes. We all make mistakes. Who hasn't made a mistake? No hands. All the good I've tried to do, strengthen, bless, and carry through. We want the Lord's energy to bring forth the good that's in us in a greater way, to enhance that goodness and carry it through to where it needs to be so that people are served. All that good comes from us, through us, and into the world. You don't have to say it all over to remember all the lines. Lord, thou knowest how I live. All I've done amiss, forgive. All the good I've tried to do, strengthen, bless, and carry through. And then all I love in safety keep. We want the Lord to keep all that we love safe and dear. And while in thee I fall asleep. And then we can lay our heads down and know we've given it all up to God. So can we say that prayer together? Lord, thou knowest how I live. All I've done amiss, forgive. All the good I've tried to do, strengthen, bless, and carry through. All I love is safety keep, while in thee I fall asleep. Amen. Thank you. A little children's prayer that covers all the eventualities of what we need. First of all, remembering to be humble before God, that God knows our prayers before we even ask them, and hears us and knows us better than we know ourselves. Good reminder for everyday living. So I hope you'll enjoy it and keep that prayer and use it for your own relief at night when you've had a big day. Maybe that will help you let everything go before you fall asleep. Thank you, Grandma Becky. Let's join together in singing hymn number 478. let us join together, joining our hearts and our minds and our souls. Dear Lord, we give thanks that you know us, you guide us, you love us, you live with us and within us, bringing us more fully into your presence every time we follow your guidance. Every time we come to you in prayer, every time we lean on you for strength. And we give thanks this day for the many ways in which we can come to you, find you, and be strengthened by you. Our prayers are words in our minds that are lifted up to you, but the true prayer is the union with you in our very souls, where we feel your presence, know your love, and are enlightened by your wisdom. We pray for those who are in need, that we might lift up their names to you, not that you do not know that they are in need, but that we have the need to lift up their names so that you might bless them and also bless us with the knowledge of how to be of service to them. We pray for Desiree. We pray for Ethan. We pray for our country. We pray for Nick and Grace. We pray for Ted. We pray for Lily. We pray for Ava. We pray for Ben. I invite you to lift up the names of others who are on your hearts today.
Jim Peters. Shirley. The Shrey. Schrager family. The Bousquets.
Debbie.
Colleen. Hear us now, Lord, as we pray in the silence of our hearts. Dear Lord, in these prayers and as in all things, we ask that your divine will be done. Hear us now as we pray in the words that you've taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would you please rise and join me in the affirmation of faith found in the bulletin? Redeemer of the world, in whom is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, whose humanity is divine, who for our salvation did come into the world and take our nature upon him. He endured temptation, even to the passion of the cross. He overcame the hells, and so delivered man. He glorified his humanity, uniting it with the divinity of which it was begotten. Without this, no mortal could have been saved, and they are saved who believe in him and keep the commandments of his word. This is his commandment, that we love one another as he has loved us. Amen. Now let us join in singing hymn number 587.
Scripture reading this morning is the first from Psalm 17. I call on you, my God, for you will answer me. Turn your ear to me and hear my prayer. Show me the wonders of your great love, you who save by your right hand those who take refuge in you from their foes. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me in the shadow of your wings, from the wicked who are out to destroy me, from my mortal enemies who surround me. And from Ephesians 6, verse 18. And pray the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people.
As I was preparing for our meditation today, I thought, well, let's do this in silence. We certainly have a lot of noise in the world around us all the time. And let's open ourselves to whatever comes in this moment. It's a matter of having the intention to listen, quieting the body, calming the mind. There are many ways in which people offer guided meditations, but I would simply say this morning that as we enter into the silence, we ask that the Lord be within us, speak to us, show us the way, and warm our hearts. And we'll end our time of prayer with the bow. I want you to bring your attention back into the room. This start of the year, our sermon topics are all from the suggestion box. So prayer was one of the topics that people wanted to hear more about. And when I did a little research, I found that it is part of almost all the world religions to pray, and I was able to find the lovely little interfaith prayer book. And not only does it have prayers from different religions, but it also has a little bit of a view about how they view prayer. So I'd like to share with you from five of the world's religious traditions about what prayer means to them. And this is a Jewish view of prayer. Prayer, its Hebrew name is tefillah, a word that gives us an insight into the Torah's concept of prayer. The root of tefillah means to judge, to differentiate, to clarify, and to decide. In life, we constantly sort out evidence from rumor, valid options from wild speculations, fact from fancy. Thus, prayer is the soul's yearning to define what truly matters and to ignore the trivialities that often masquerade as essential. And from the Hindu tradition, prayer is nearness to God. It is tuning one's mind with the mind of God. It is focusing the thoughts on God and meditating on Him. Prayer is surrendering oneself to God completely, and melting the mind and the ego in silence in God. Prayer represents a mystic state when the individual's consciousness is absorbed in God. It is an uplifting of the soul to God, an act of love and adoration to God. It is worship and glorification of God. It is thanksgiving to God for all his blessings. Now, the Buddhists use the word meditation, but it is also a quieting of the mind. And it is a time to be in a new kind of awareness with the divine. And this is what they wrote. Meditation quiets the mind. By focusing on a single sound or idea, troubling thoughts are set aside and peace enters. Mantra meditation is chanting meditation. One sits quietly and repeats certain sacred words or phrases. The goal is to reach a higher state of consciousness and spiritual ecstasy. And this is a quote from John Wesley about Christian prayer. God's command to pray without ceasing is founded on the necessity we have of his grace to preserve the life of God in the soul, which can no more subsist one moment without it than the body can without air. Whether we think of or speak to God, whether we act or suffer for him, all is prayer, when we have no other object than his love and the desire of pleasing him. All that a Christian does, even in eating and sleeping, is prayer, when it is done in simplicity according to the order of God, without either adding to or diminishing from it by his own choice. Prayer continues in the desire of the heart, though the understanding be employed on outward things. In souls filled with love, the desire to please God is a continual prayer. And finally, I have a quote from a Sufi, and a Sufism is a sect of Islam, and they follow the same five times a day prayer as other Islam. Sufism is a more mystical sect. The Swedenborgianism is a mystical sect of Christianity. Sufism is a mystical sect of Islam. Following celestial law, the earth each day performs a complete turning. The light moves through five stages as the sun dawns, climbs to its zenith, descends downward into the slanting rays of afternoon, sets in glowing colors, and disappears into darkness. For the Sufi, this cycle is a mirror of the human lifespan. Our dawning into the world, our growth, maturation, decline, and death. In these five stages, the soul makes its journey around another sun that never rises or sets. Five times the prayer throughout the day invites us to awaken from the superficial self at these moments of the day. By aligning our devotional work with these natural times of power, we start to move with the rhythm of God's creation in a new way, attuned to the mystical correspondences between outer and inner, and to the seasons of life. Oh, and there's one from Swedenborg. Swedenborg wrote about prayer and said, "Prayer regarded in itself is speech with God, and some internal view at the time of the matters of the prayer, to which there answers something like an influx into the perception or thought of the mind, so that there is a certain opening of the person's interiors towards God, but this with a difference according to the person's state and according to the essence of the subject of the prayer. If the person prays from love and faith and for only heavenly and spiritual things, there then comes forth in the prayer something like a revelation, which is manifested in the affection of those who pray as to hope, consolation, or a certain inward joy. It is from this that to pray signifies, in the internal sense, to be revealed." So I have to ask, how did it feel to be quiet? Anybody antsy in their seat? Hard to stop thinking. Hard to stop thinking about what comes next this afternoon, or what you did this morning. Quieting ourselves for prayer is very hard, but we need it. We need it because we need to be quiet enough to hear God within us. to hear the answers. We can't be busy talking. We can't be busy with the expression of prayer, which, as we mentioned earlier, God knows what we're praying for. God already knows our insides. But I like what Swedenborg said about there's an opening according to the person's state and according to the essence and subject of the prayer. And that when we pray for heavenly and spiritual things, we have come forth something like a revelation. Now, we can pray for material things as well. And many people have complained to me about how often they've been praying and their prayers are not being answered. Well, when we're praying for something very specific, it can be true. Very often that specific prayer is not answered. But the intention behind that prayer, what was it? Was it a heavenly and spiritual desire? Was it something that you prayed about because it would enhance others as well as yourself? That the answer to the prayer, the answer that comes to you, might be that that situation cannot be changed for the good of the larger good that the Lord sees. The Lord sees with an eternal view. We certainly don't. He doesn't have the limitation of saying, well, oh, this, we need to make sure that this happens because this person's unhappy. Maybe that unhappiness is a lesson that will then change that person for the future and bring them into fuller angelhood. As we read in the different traditions, the Jewish tradition, the soul's yearning to define what truly matters, to have only the highest ideals in our minds, only the things that really are important for the long run, not just for right now. And the Hindu prayer talked about surrendering oneself. That's the humility that I spoke about in the children's prayer that we shared. That surrendering oneself and the humility before God to accept that the answer to the prayer, you might have to open your mind to see it. It might not come in the way you expect. As the Buddha states, that this time of meditation and allowing the Lord to enter in can lift us up to a higher state of consciousness and indeed spiritual ecstasy. And John Wesley's pray without ceasing. When are we not praying? When we have in our mind the good of others, the usefulness that we can bring into the world, inquiry into higher understandings of life, caring with compassion for those who need it. This is prayer without ceasing, when it's in our heart and our head and in our actions throughout our lives. And in the Sufi tradition, they mention awakening from the superficial self. We all have a superficial self. We're quite adept at being superficial selves. We do it all the time. We got dressed, we had our breakfast, we got in the car, we drove here. All those are the superficials of life. But prayer is opening ourselves to a deeper divine relationship within. It is in fully being in that state of humility, knowing that it is through the Lord that we open ourselves to being changed, and it is through the Lord that we actually have the energy to put that which we pray for into action. When we accept God's love into our intentions, and God's wisdom into our understanding, and God's energy into our bodies, we then become vessels for God with our full hearts, minds, and experience. And the soul is the entry point. We live with God in our inmost. The question is, are we in touch with God? Are we in relationship with God? And are we living that relationship with God? Another quote here, this is from Unity. When we are truly aware of the presence of God in the silence of prayer, everything in us responds. Our cells respond and glow with life and light. Our minds are charged with the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Our feelings are blessed and transformed by the power of God's love. When we come to God in prayer, we may think that we come asking, but we find, as we make ourselves willing and open channels for spirit, that we are no longer askers, but responders. Now, Wouldn't that be nice to be able to identify that we are first responders? When God tells us what to do, we're there, we're on it. That we each have different lives, different relationships, different engagements with others in the world, and if we can come prayerfully to everything we do, we are bringing God into every situation. We are bringing all that we are and all that God can do through us. And my final quote is also from Unity, and they say, "The power of prayer is the power to live a full, abundant life. It is the power to let go of negativity and to stand steadfastly on the promises of God. It is the power to step out in faith to achieve goals. It is the power to see the perfect expression of God in each individual and circumstance. This is power, the power of prayer. From our moments of prayer, we enter the world again, our minds and bodies strengthened and renewed, our faith rekindled, and our trust in God's will of good affirmed. The answer to our prayers may not take the exact form we desire, but we know that God answers every prayer in the highest and best manner possible for everyone." Living prayer, living a life of prayer, a life of prayer without ceasing, is heavenly community on earth. It's the humility that we hold that all is from the Lord. It is the willingness to open ourselves to God in prayer and in meditation, both speaking and listening. And we need it because it helps us articulate and know for ourselves what it is we truly desire. God is not confused. We are. We need prayer to clarify. And then from that, we need to act from the love and wisdom that we receive from God to live the power of prayer, which is the power of life. Let us pray. Lord, we know that you know our inmost hearts. You know all that we are thinking and feeling. You know our history, and you are with us now, inspiring in each of us the way to move into the day. We ask that you help us to be your hands and feet and words in the world. May we be inspired by your love, that we might be compassionate. May we be inspired by your wisdom to have greater understanding. And may we be inspired by your energy, the power to live a life of prayer without ceasing, having you in every word, in every act, in every thought. Help us to draw closer to you. In your gracious name we pray. Amen. For our offertory today, there's an insert in your bulletin, and it's the Lord's Prayer. It's a Caribbean version. And we're going to sing that. The choir will be leading it, and we're going to just have you all sing along. help each one of us to pray without ceasing and give all that we can to the betterment of the world and those around us. Amen. Now, on your inserts, you have one called Standing in the Need of Prayer, which we're going to sing through twice.
Thank you.
fellowship.